So this meeting will be webcast and a record retained on the council website for up to 2 years. By participating in this meeting, you are consenting for your name, the content of what you say and your image to be broadcast and stored to the council website. If any member, an officer or member of the public addressing the committee has concerns with this, please contact the committee services officer immediately. Those at home viewing the webcast, I'd like to inform you that if you look above the video, you will see the resources tab. Select this and the link to the agenda will appear on the right hand side. This will allow you to open the agenda in PDF form and follow the discussion and debate. And before we move on to decorations and interest, I'd just like to take this opportunity to welcome our new Director of Public Health, Dave. You first have not been more.
Thanks, Chair. Thanks for the nice welcome. And yeah, pleasure to be here. I'm really looking forward to working for many years, hopefully.
Okay, so declarations of interest, do any members have any disclosable pecuniary or any other interest in connection with any agenda items? No, okay. So apologies for absence, we've got Councillor Tom Anderson, Councillor Yvonne Nolan, Kerry Bennett and Karen Howell, Wirral Community Healthcare Foundation Trust. Dave Hammond, is here? Yeah, nice to see you. So David and Janelle Holmes from Wirral University Teaching Hospital, so Mike Gibbs is attending on their behalf, I am. And Sue Higginson is unable to make it, she's from Wirral Met College. So we've got Michael Norton attending. Nice to see you. So can I ask the committee to approve the accuracy of the minutes that were, of the meeting that were held on the 29th of September 2022? Are you happy with that? Oh, I'm going to move that, sorry, do I have a second then? Kathy, thank you. Thank you. Are we all happy to agree those licenses? Thank you. So we don't have any questions from the public, we don't have any statements or petitions, and we have no member questions. So we'll move straight on to agenda item 5, which is Wirral Worklessness Support Service, and Sally, you're going to introduce this and then hand over to the Wirral North West, and Justine and Leah are here to talk to you about.
Thank you, Chair. And as you said, just that was introduced, Leah Fraser and Justine Molyneux from the Wirral North West, who are going to sort of talk us through the update in a minute. I just really wanted
not
to...
Leah Fraser, sorry. So just not Leah Fraser.
So it's okay.
She's one of our characters.
I stand corrected, I'm very sorry. What I'd like to do is just to start by an introduction that just, I suppose, reminds board members that you received a presentation from Involved or West just almost exactly a year ago now on the Wirral Work as a Support Service programme, and it was delivered by Involved or West because they delivered that programme on behalf of Wirral Council. The programme is part of the wider Wirral Ways to Work programme, which aims to support residents to gain employment or training or education opportunities, particularly residents who are furthest away from the opportunities from the labour market and residents in large deprived communities. Obviously this is particularly important in order to ensure that residents can gain employment opportunities, but particularly so in terms of the links that we need to make between our regeneration programme and the opportunities that we're creating as part of that wider regeneration programme, to make sure that we have those links between those opportunities created and local residents being able to take and benefit from the opportunities there. So I think I probably don't need to say much more, but to hand over to Justine and Leah to take us through the presentation.
Thank you, Sally. We were made aware that this was an update, so we were here 12 months ago, how time flies. So just a snapshot update of how the Reach Out project, which is what the project is known as from a community level, and what has happened post-pandemic and the results we've delivered in the last 12 months, not only focused on the Reach Out project, but also the recent investment from the CONF money into our Help Out project, which is primarily focused around health and wellbeing support. So Reach Out has been focused for the last 15 years on supporting people into work, primarily of benefits into work, but we identified post-COVID there was a lot of support needed for health and wellbeing, as you can imagine. team of job coaches delivering reach out did not have the capacity and resources to actually support the barriers and the impacts that were being presented to us from a health and wellbeing perspective. So we are now 6-7 months in to also delivering the help out contract with comfort money, so we're going to deliver to you some results and the impacts that that's made as well.
So just as a way of explaining the project objectives, so the objectives are to support Wirral residents gaining sustainable employment. It's really important to us that we help residents find sustainable employment so that it's not a 0 hours contract, it's something that they're going to be able to stay in, grow in as part of the Wirral population. As Leah said, we do have a project now which kind of underpins that called Help Out, which is really, really important, and especially with the cost of living crisis coming in, it's important that we're able to alleviate some of those barriers for people to be able to gain employment. We work in partnership with lots of local employers. We have an employer engagement officer who goes out actively every day to source employers that we can place the people that are on our books that are looking for employment with the right employers, and we work very closely with the job centre as well. One of the good things about Beach House is that it has time to break down some of those complex barriers that remove people from gaining sustainable employment, and again this is really critical for us to be able to do as part of the service. And tackling health inequalities by helping people gain sustainable employment, but employment that's actually targeted and focused around their needs, their wants and their aspirations, rather than it's just a job you need to go into, and that's a critical part of what this contract delivers.
Absolutely.
Sorry, I have to be quite loud, I need to move away from the microphone. So with regards to reach out, which is the unemployment focus, in the last 12 months we've had over 1,300 people who've engaged with the local project to support them back into employment, and of that 836 have actually gone into work. You may think that's a significant difference, thinking of what's happened to the rest of them. When somebody engages with us, they don't automatically go into work that week or necessarily that month. It can take 10 months, 11 months, 12 months with these individuals to support them into sustainable employment. One of the key factors of this project is not just putting people into factory work where they will then come out of work a few months later. It's all about sustainability. The last time we looked, we were very close to doubling the national average around sustainability. So we monitor and track everybody we put into work for up to 6 months and more with some clients. And we're actually at an 87% sustainability rate. So of those 836 people we put into work, 87% have actually stayed in employment for 6 months or more. So that's why their project is very much a flagship project for Wirral, because of the amount of people we keep in work, not just put into work. We're averaging around 70 local people in sustainable employment every month. That's how many people will get into job starts. And as we mentioned before, the help out, the investment into the help out project, which now underpins reach out from a health and wellbeing perspective, as actually the focus was around supporting people with health and well-being. So if somebody's looking for work, we're supporting them with job search and confidence building, interviewing techniques, goal setting, action planning. When they present their health barriers, we then move them on to a health and well-being officer. So it was all about breaking down the health barriers, but what we've actually found in the last 7 months is the help out project with the comp money has actually increased our job outcomes by 10%. On the overall reach out project, so the two projects are working hand in glove. I want to just provide you with just some trends that we picked up over the last 12 months post-COVID. We found a significant increase in long-term unemployment. So people who've been unemployed for 2 years or more, some 6, 7, 8 years, they're coming to us because they cannot now live and survive on their benefits alone. So we are working with people significantly with disabilities, and we're trying to focus on what they can do rather than what they can't do. So we're having a lot of long-term unemployment individuals coming through to us. We've also found a lot of people coming to us looking for second jobs to help with the cost of living because they just financially can't survive, or they're struggling, or they're worrying what's about to be coming forward over the next few months particularly. This project is around supporting people who are not in work, but we're never going to turn somebody away. If somebody comes to us and says, I'm working 16 hours, I need help, I need more, I need to see where, what else I can do, and I need to fulfil my aspirations of gaining more work and upskilling myself, we're not going to turn people away. So at the moment, although it's an unemployment contract,
probably 10% of our time, around 10% of our time at the moment, is actually helping people who are actually employed even more, and a lot of that is financially motivated as well. We found a significant reduction in zero-hour contracts being offered by employers, and this was one of our biggest barriers as delivering this contract pre-COVID, because a lot of employers were taking advantage of vulnerable people, really, open out of work for a while, and offering zero-hour contracts. People didn't know what income they had, but COVID has put a stop to that, and employers, that there is a lot of jobs out there now, so we're quite fortunate after COVID that there is employment out there, and the zero-hour contracts has significantly reduced. We're also finding there's a lot of carers. People actually left their jobs, gave up their jobs to look after their vulnerable family members. Through COVID, we're finding a lot of carers coming to us now to go back into work, so that's something we've noticed, that there's been quite a bit of a trend around that as well. And also people are receiving PIP, the Payment Independence payments, which is disability focused but not means tested. A lot of people are coming to us now on these disability benefits saying, I need a job, it's not enough, I can't survive, and a lot of it is anxiety driven about what the future is going to hold for them regarding the financial crisis. Just a couple of snapshots of Help Out, which is the wellbeing outcomes. So the conf money, what that's done in the last, September, six months, 128 people have actually accessed support through Help Out. Now these people, don't worry if you complicate this, these individuals can only be referred from the Reach Out Unemployment contract. So anybody who's looking for work, who feels overwhelmed, is a little bit lost with themselves, the Reach Out job coaches, to take the pressure off them, they refer to the Help Out team. When I say the Help Out team, we have two counsellors and one psychological therapist who has joined the team, and they remove barriers, do goal setting, deal with anxiety, stress, just a range of issues that people are struggling with. So 128 people come through. I got the updates today, we've had another 31 in the month of October. We've actually got 71 now, an update as of today. 71 people have actually gone into work through the Help Out project, and 94% of these individuals reported an improvement by our SWEM website. It's the health and wellbeing monitoring tool that we use to say that they've significantly improved on their wellbeing and they feel more able to cope. Help Out has had a great impact on sustainability, so it helps people stay in work as well. So people come with barriers and problems, we put them in a job, they normally can collapse and fall down within the first couple of months, and they go back into their comfort zone, being back on benefits. So Help Out has made a significant impact on that as well.
One of the things that Reach Out does is we provide 27 weekly job clubs all over Wirral for people to access in lots of different venues. But we were really acutely conscious that if you can't access a venue or you can't come into one of our locations, how can you get this level of support that we provide? So with our Help Out money that we received, one of the things that we did was we bought a camper van. So it's kind of a web club meeting space, go and talk to an advisor on wheels, on the ground. At the moment, it's going out 15 times a month to different locations all across the world, and we go out with partner agencies as well. So you can actually go and see a job coach in your local area, parked up somewhere, and we do heavily advertise it all over social media. And just a few things that we've been involved with, so we've been to Life Angel, we've been to ASDA, we've helped Wirral Council with the social care recruitment, and we've done the Marine View Nursing Home recruitment event in Brighton. And then we've been to a number of employees as well. But it's a really excellent way of anybody being able to access the service. So there shouldn't be any barriers to be able to come to us to look for a job and be supported, because you can either see us through anything that we do or through the camper van, which is becoming more popular as we go along.
One thing we have done with the camper van, we take it down the prom, we go to any events that's local, we go along to summer fairs, summer events. And we were noticed by Somerville Primary School in Egremont, made contact with the head, they came out and spoke to us and asked us what we were all about. On the back of that, we've been invited in and we've been along to two parents even so far and started engaging with some local parents. The head teacher has since made contact with us, we've promoted Reach Out and employment opportunities, and the head has asked us could we make this a regular visit. So on the back of that, we are now in contact with some local schools to go and talk to parents about looking for employment opportunities. And so that has sort of been a byproduct of taking the van out and being driving around. But it's great to see we're now linking in attendance on local schools and raising awareness of employment and what opportunities are up there as well. So we just wanted to share, I know you packed in the presentation, we've got a number of case studies, but I wanted to focus on the last one, which is a gentleman called David. So David's in his 50s and he's male, obviously, and he's unemployed. David lost both his parents to COVID, so he really wasn't in a very good place. He didn't have any support, he was extremely isolated. He was still grieving, struggling financially and also mentally. David's been supported by the Reach Out team, which obviously this took a while to build his confidence, to help him gain some new skills, to help him be work ready to go back into the labour market. He needed help with IT, with interviewing skills, and also help from the Help Out team around coping with his mental health and looking at strategies that would help him move forward. It took several months of support from both of the teams to get David ready, and David was interested in the hospitality sector. The Reach Out team were also able to help David get a travel pass and some vouchers to purchase some new work clothes and shoes. David still remains in work right now and is very thankful for the support that the Reach Out team have given him. David went on to say that when he became employed, he gained so much more than he gained his life back from the very difficult position that he found himself in. And that really is just a snapshot of the type of people that come to Reach Out and to the Help Out service to be fully supported. And I know a lot of clients that come to us and are with us a long time feel as though they're coming to talk to a friend. And I know certainly during COVID, when we were still operational, that some of our clients were literally just phoning, not necessarily always for support to get back into employment, but just for that mental health support as well. So we're extremely proud of the service that we deliver. And thank you for listening to our presentation.
Thank you for that. Absolutely. Yeah. Just want to say thank you for what you're doing, really. I think it's beyond dispute, isn't it, that having employment sustainable, that's the word that kept jumping out to me. Sustainable employment allows people to live a life that's more fulfilled and the people's mental, physical well-being, for the self-esteem as well. When I lost my job about 10 years ago, I mean, I was redeployed quite quickly, so that period of time that I was facing unemployment was probably the worst of my life, because the world gets pulled out from under you. When that goes, it's not just a job, it's your identity really, isn't it, as well, it's everything. So, I mean, what I took from that as well is, apart from the sustainable employment which you're helping people find, which I think is crucial, because I'm glad that you picked up on the fact that people are being exploited with 0 hours contracts anyway, and still are, but I'm glad to see that that's reduced a little bit. People who ordinarily might have relied upon disability benefits and now are having to go look for work too. So that was really, really interesting, so thank you for that. You're doing great work, keep it up. I'm just going to throw it over to your comments now.
This is really important work, and I think it's great to see that you've got involved in the recruitment events around social care, as you can imagine. That's an area that I really feel that there's a lot that we can do together, because we have lots of unfilled jobs right across the sector in terms of social care, and we're really struggling to get enough people into working in that market. Councils have put loads of extra money in, so we've increased pay rates to make it very similar to that in the hospitality businesses now, £1 an hour. But we're so keen, and I just don't know if there's more we can do. I don't know if you've got any comment in terms of what we could do more to really make it an attractive type of proposition for people to work in care.
Thank you, great.
And
we were actually up with Wirral Council at the New Ferry when you had one of your adult social care recruitment events, which was very well received, that you shared back by the team. I'm not sure if there's a key contact within your section that we could liaise with and link with, but absolutely any events you've got going or anything that we can do. We do find hospitality and care is quite a competitive sector, and we're finding that ourselves, and but anything we could do, when we work with local employers, we do a lot of their CV sifting, but we've got the pool of people first. So we're doing the CVs and getting them interview ready. We do recruitment days. We did one for B&M. We took over their whole recruitment day for them, sifted through people. and did skills testing. So if there's anything we can do on your behalf to take away the recruitment headache and do sifting and do all of that for you, we can certainly do that. Or any events, we can get the van out with the job coaches.
Particularly as you said as well, that you've got a lot of carers coming to you, so there's a skill set already there.
Absolutely, yes. We've seen that. That's been an increasing trend over the last 6 months. It filtered in slowly at the beginning, and a lot of it, when we spoke to the carers, a lot of them was their own confidence, because they've known no different, but it was just taking that step, as you said, that their whole lives changed. It was them taking that first step of, this is all I've known. It's our job to also give them that confidence to say you can do something and you can put those skills and transfer them to employment. Confidence is huge at the moment. A lot of people are pretty much at rock bottom, and COVID's had a significant effect on people. There is a flip side to this. We're also finding people coming to us who have actually had jobs working home and they don't want it anymore. They feel completely isolated. So they're in work, but they're in work with a screen, and people we'll find that this starts to come through. People do want the attraction with other people. So we're finding that we're getting some people, as I said before, who are employed. People's behaviours and trends have changed so much since COVID. And they're saying, I want a job with people. I don't want to sit at home alone anymore. And also the rise in energy bills, they've got that on top of it. And the salaries are not justifying that.
It's a moving picture, isn't it? Sorry, did you have your hand up?
Yeah, just on that point, there's an organisation called Capacity. We've got a project called there's an organisation called Capacity. We've got a project called Juno. It's about reimagining care homes, which is probably not a lot of people aware of, or care homes on wheels. But they're doing a big recruitment drive at the moment, and the way they've gone about it just feels really interesting and different. And like they've basically split there's two different roles. So say you're looking for care home staff, they've actually split it down the middle. There's like a different pay grade and a different understanding if you're new to that line of work or you've already worked in it before. Which I think for people who are maybe daunted by, or have never done it before, or you know, change of scenery, it's quite interesting to do it like that. And a lot of their recruitment is built around exploring different angles, or trying to be non-traditional really, so not just sit down and tell them the answer, maybe it's a good answer, you get the job. It's like actually getting them to engage with people in a different way. So probably some shared learning, isn't it?
And this is the joy of this health and wellbeing board, isn't it? As we say, jigsaw pieces start to fit together. Did you want to do anything?
Yeah, I mean, you've already said it really, but I just wanted to say just how blown away I was by some of the results that you were bringing out from that piece of work. I think it's really crucial just how important sustainable employment is for people's health and wellbeing going forward. I was really struck by what you said around making that link. Supporting them with the health work and actually increase your sustainability as well. I think that was really powerful. And also I really like the fact that you were doing a systematic when-when evaluation of it, and it clearly shows that 94%, I think I've noted down, are showing significant improvement in your foot self-reported well-being. So I think that's just really kind of applauding you really, so well done.
Well, that's a huge big, I think, collective performance up and running there. Well, yeah, well done to people that we were. So I'm just going to you that we know the reports and the information contained in it, so that you have a second look at that. Thank you. Are you okay, so we'll read that by a sentence. Thank you very much. Thank you so much. Agenda item 6 is Wirral Place Upgrade Report and Simon Backstory for you.
Thank you, Chair. I'm Simon Banks, I'm the Place Director for NHS Cheshire and Merseyside for Wirral. The report suffers a little bit from having to prepare these things in advance for meetings. So I will give some verbal updates in terms of some of the items covered in the report. So the first section of the report refers to obviously the establishment of NHS Cheshire and Merseyside of integrated care systems. As of the 1st of July this year. NHS Cheshire and Merseyside board meetings are meetings in public. The venues move around Cheshire and Merseyside, so we were down in Crewe last Thursday at one of their leisure centres. We will be having the Wirral hosting of the meeting, will be the Floral Pavilion on the morning of the 26th of January. So we'll be organising as part of that sort of a fair, as it were, of local services, showcasing what we do on Wirral as part of that. So as I said, that's a meeting in public that will be from roughly 10 o'clock, I think, on the 26th of January at the floor of the pavilion. As part of the governance arrangements for NHS Cheshire and Merseyside, we're committed very much to working in partnership arrangements in each of the places, and the Wirral Place-Based Partnership Board met for the first time on the 13th of October. The next meeting is on the 10th of November at 10 o'clock, will be webcast, and again is a meeting in public. Items that we would receive there, we look at the impact of how we put some of the system strategies into practice operationally. We will start to receive reports on issues of quality, performance and financial management of the Wirral Health and Care system. And we're currently also working through what that looks like in terms of finalising the governance arrangements for that. That will include appointing a chair and a vice chair from the membership. I don't need as place director to chair such meetings. I would prefer to service them as an officer. And it's important that the chair and vice chair arrangements, which are effectively about the effective running of a meeting, pass around members of the partnership. So we have a group of people working on that at the moment. The membership of the board is drawn from representatives from voluntary community, faith and social enterprise sector, from primary care, from our provider organisations, from the council, both officers and elected members. And when it is also a committee in common of NHS Cheshire Merseyside and Wirral Council for when we need to make decisions around pooled budgets, pooled funds and things like the Better Care Fund. So therefore the people in the room become participants in that decision making process as well. So as I said, the next meeting is on the 10th of November. The third part of the report again has moved on somewhat. On the 29th of July, the Department of Health and Social Care issued statutory guidance requiring each integrated care partnership to publish a strategy by December. Our integrated care partnership is referred to as Cheshire and Merseyside Health and Care Partnership, and under the legislation, an integrated care partnership is where the NHS part of the system comes together with the local authority and other partners. And I think that is also chaired by a local authority elected member. It has a key role in assessing health, public and health and social care needs of Cheshire and Merseyside, and that strategy seeks to address them. Now, given the very, very short timescales to produce this, a decision was made by the Integrated Care Partnership, by NHS, by Cheshire and Merseyside Health and Care Partnership, that we should draw upon existing health and wellbeing strategies from across the system. And this board signed off a very excellent piece of work last month in terms of a Wirral health and wellbeing strategy, the outcomes framework associated with it. So Dave and I, our teams, have been asked to get together a very short 4 or 5 pages to go in that strategy, which will be the headlines from the health and wellbeing strategy, the items you can find on the Wirral Information Service website around the mapping of the life course in Wirral, which you'll be familiar with, things like what if Wirral was a village of 100 people, what it would look like, and where we sit against some of our key performance indicators. And the outcome framework you signed off last month is very much an important part of that. So once the health and care partnership strategy is produced, we will share that later with the Health and Wellbeing Board. The other thing that's moved on in terms of the place maturity framework self-assessment, each of the 9 places in Cheshire and Merseyside were asked to do a return to see where they felt they were in terms of their development in 4 key domains around ambition and vision, leadership and culture, design and delivery and governance. And we did that by asking colleagues across the system to produce evidence to back up where we felt we were assessing ourselves against. We feel that we are a very much a, I forget, so the four domains, I just need to remind myself of the four domains, so I actually accurately represent where we were. We believe that we're an established partnership, and in some areas moving towards thriving, so that puts us in the third area of that assessment framework, which is quite extensive. We also did a survey of the members of the place-based partnership board, and we had our place meeting on the 26th of October. The meeting was essentially in two parts. The first was some scrutiny of our winter plans as a system. So how are we collectively preparing to ensure that we keep people out of hospital settings, we care for people in appropriate environments. If people do end up in hospital settings, how do we move them out back to their homes or home-like environments in a effective manner? But also how do we maintain health and care services during that time, and particularly maintain the recovery of elective care, so operations people have been waiting for some time. We have, I think, a robust plan as a place. We have worked together over many, many months and years on these issues. We are now, I think, in a position where we have identified that some of our key risks are, and we are seeking some additional support from my colleagues in NHS Cheshire and Merseyside and also NHS England to move some of those things along. So, effectively, I think from that meeting we identified some of our biggest challenges being around capacity in the domiciliary care market and the availability of care packages, which links very nicely to the presentation you've heard before.